Welcome to 24 Hours Finance. Hope you're having a great day today. In today's video, I'll be discussing Citadel, or should I say Citadel CEO Ken Griffin's recent interview, talking about entering China's financial markets again. I'll be discussing why the interview matters for us apes and playing a short clip of the interview to see it from the horse's mouth yourself. But before we start, please smash that like button for the YouTube algorithm and subscribe for more content. Getting right into it, in this interview, you'll notice that he's reading off of a teleprompter and it's super scripted to the point where it's hard to watch. I've taken the liberty of breaking it down for you so that you don't have to watch the full interview in agony. I'll be playing a short clip of the interview instead and discussing what this means for us apes. I've posted the link for the full interview in the description below if you are interested. Here we go.
So Citadel has entered China in 2010. You've witnessed both bull and bear markets, a big crash and the following rounds of regulation changes, this and that. In your view, what roles can foreign firms play in helping China develop a more mature capital market, especially with greater long-term investment?
So I think it's important to recognize that Citadel has been active in Asia since 1990, the year of the founding of the business. And in fact, we were an important investor in Hong Kong throughout the 1990s, where we saw a tremendous opportunity created by the Hong Kong entrepreneurs. We've been involved in mainland China from the early days of Citadel Securities, and we've seen a continued focus by the Chinese policymakers on creating one of the world's most transparent and fair markets in which to participate. China has, for example, been at the forefront of embracing markets that have openness and transparency through electronic trading, that helps to give people around the world confidence in the equity and fairness of dealing in China. Now that we see American firms working with Chinese firms on a number of different fronts, for example, raising capital, we're seeing the sharing of best practices between our two countries in the allocation of capital, in how to think about risk management, in how to think about the development of new markets, for example, a high yield financing market that will broaden the tools available to Chinese corporates to accelerate growth, and at the same time, creating more opportunities for Chinese savers to deploy their savings in thoughtful ways.
Thanks for sharing those interesting stories and anecdotes. Now let's go back and focus on Citadel.
Now that is actually hilarious that she says, thanks for those interesting stories and anecdotes, like she doesn't believe any of it, right? But getting back on track, in this interview, it seems he is courting friendship with China, as he is willing to say whatever pleases the Chinese government, and the questions asked were all fluff pieces. Maybe this is due to him looking for a lifeline so he can escape when shit goes south and not be extradited for his financial crimes. I wouldn't be surprised if he already had a safe house there and offshore accounts stashed with millions. The most ironic part about this interview is he talks about helping China's economy when Citadel was actually banned from trading in China for 5 years starting in 2015. Let me pull up the article here for you to take a look. From this article here, you can see they were fined $97 million in 2020 after investigations revealed they crashed the mainland metal market with illegal short selling. They use the same illegal short selling tactics they are using now in the US today, including AMC and GameStop. You may be wondering why China would let them back into their financial markets if they're already known for illegal trading practices. So let me refer you to the article here. As you can see here, Chinese regulators, however, didn't ban the practice entirely, but after the scrutiny, investors can't sell and then buy shares back the same day. Instead, they must now wait after completion of a short sale transaction until at least the next day to repurchase. So this was one of the rules they put in to pretty much counteract the manipulation of short selling. Another reason for letting them back in would be based off Deng Xiaoping's economic theory, where he was the former Chinese revolution leader and politician who served as the paramount leader of the People's Republic of China. Deng's economic theory should be taken into consideration, as it essentially states that China has to bait Western companies to do business in China to allow them to develop faster and enter the second stage of their socialist economy. And as you can see here, it does mention here, in the view of Deng, the task faced by the leadership of China was twofold, promoting modernization of Chinese economy and preserving the ideological unity of the Communist Party of China and its control of the difficult reforms required by modernization. So definitely that's what he's referring to there. So in conclusion, it looks like Ken Griffin's in the hot seat and it's starting to warm up even more as he nervously looks for alternatives overseas to seek capital and safety. I got my fingers crossed and hoping us apes put him out of his misery sooner than later with the MOAS. Other than that, please smash the like and subscribe button if you enjoy this content and enjoy the rest of your day. Peace out. I get it.